To most, Kenneth Rexroth's influence is confined to the literary realm. Seeing as his work inspired the Beat Generation poets of the 1950s, this isn't all that surprising. And yet, the first edition of his autobiography ends when he is just 22 and a full 13 years before his first poetry collection was published in 1940. In this episode of Talking Hoosier History, we'll explore the Midwestern makings of this literary icon and his connections with anarchists, burlesque dancers, criminals, and the leading thinkers of his age. Hello and welcome to Talking Hoosier History. This episode features the 2016 and 2017 Indiana Poet Laureate Sherry Wagner reading the works of Kenneth Rexroth. This podcast is brought to you by the Indiana Historical Bureau. For over a century, we've been marking Hoosier history. Now it's time to start talking Hoosier history. I'm your host, Lindsay Beckley. Kenneth Rexroth was born on December 22, 1905, in South Bend, Indiana. According to his sometimes colorfully embellished autobiography, his birth was something of an adventure. He wrote,
"My mother was well past her time. She was sitting in a cabaret, eating breast of chicken on whole wheat bread with a piece of lettuce and drinking a glass of champagne, as she always did in cabarets, and wondering when I was going to show up when she began to feel labor pains. My parents were visiting in Elkhart, but they had the curious idea of hurrying up to Chicago for the baby's birth. My mother was taken off the train in South Bend, and I was born there."
That scene, so rich in detail for an event Kenneth wasn't even alive to witness, is fairly typical for his autobiographical novel. While many of the broad strokes of his story can be corroborated with primary sources, some of these finer details we just kind of have to take his word on. Something to keep in mind later when I refer back to his autobiography. The Rexroth family, Charles, Delia, and Kenneth, enjoyed an upper-middle-class lifestyle in the early years of Kenneth's life. They lived first in a house on Park Avenue in South Bend, he described as substantial and comfortable, and later on Beardsley Avenue in Elkhart, where, quote, "all the best homes in the town were in those days." Charles worked as a traveling pharmaceutical salesman, and Delia began to see to Kenneth's education, something she did quite enthusiastically. According to Rexroth, she taught him to read between the ages of 3 and 4, and he had read hundreds of books, including Charles Dickens, at an early age. This early influence of his mother was a lasting one. He remained a prolific reader his whole life. Circumstances soon changed for the small family, though. Charles suffered from alcoholism and Delia from an unknown chronic illness. In 1910, the family was forced to leave that avenue where all the best homes in town were due to financial difficulties. They moved more often thereafter, but young Kenneth continued to immerse himself in classical literature. He also learned French, explored the neighborhood, and when he was just 6 or 7, fell in love with Helen, quote, "the little girl next door." Charles's drinking and Delia's illness had a deteriorating effect on the couple's relationship. When Rexroth was 9, the family moved briefly to Battle Creek, Michigan, then to Chicago the following year to live with relatives. Around this time, Charles's alcoholism led him to death's door and he left the family, likely going to some sort of sanitarium for treatment. Rexroth and his mother moved into a small apartment and rarely saw Charles. In 1916, Delia succumbed to what was most likely tuberculosis. Even in her last days, she was a positive influence on Kenneth's life, stressing the importance of never allowing anyone to deter him from becoming an artist and writer. After his mother's death, Rexroth went to live with his father and grandmother in Toledo, Ohio. Here, Rexroth began to seek trouble. And with little adult supervision, there was plenty of trouble to be found. In Toledo, he ran errands for brothels and sold popcorn to the working girls. Although he was only 11, he frequented burlesque shows and set up side hustles all over the city. He ran with a gang of boys who did, quote, a regular business in hot bicycles and automobile accessories, and spent their days, quote, drinking homemade beer they had stolen from their parents' cellars. During this time, he also witnessed the violent and deadly Willie's Overland Strike of 1919, a conflict where young Rexroth sided with the auto workers, and which he considered his introduction to the labor movement. In that same year, perhaps when Rexroth most needed an authority figure in his life, his father succumbed to his alcoholism. The 15-year-old Rexroth, now orphaned, went to Chicago to live with his aunt. He enrolled in public school, but, by his own account, had become a consummate master in the art of plausible hooky, and was soon expelled for his poor attendance. That was the end of his formal schooling, but he found a much more profound education awaited him outside the confines of the classroom. He gained access to the clubs of the poets and writers gathered in Chicago during the second wave of the Chicago literary renaissance. His favorite of these was the Washington Park Bug Club. Also known as Bug House Square, this club was a widely recognized center of free speech, and Rexroth encountered radical political views of all types at the meetings held there. While Bug House Square expanded Rexroth's political horizons, the amusingly named Dill Pickle Club helped him develop artistically. The club hosted independent theater productions, lectures on various topics, and, on Saturday nights, the jazz music and dancing lasted all night long. In these Chicago cultural hotspots, Rexroth started performing his poetry and rubbed elbows with political and literary giants. Rexroth soon outgrew the hustles of his youth and began working odd jobs. One of these jobs was at the Green Mask. There, Rexroth was able to see and perform poetry with some of the era's best poets and jazz musicians, eventually combining the two art forms into what would later be recognized as jazz poetry. However, the club was raided by police and the owner arrested for being the, quote, keeper of a disorderly house. Rexroth was arrested in the same raid and sentenced to a year in jail. He emerged after a hard winter in the Chicago House of Correction, having grown a little closer to the underworld, as he put it. In late December 1926, after months spent pursuing various young women, Rexroth met the artist Andre Schaefer through friends. Although they only met briefly, Rexroth pronounced that he intended to marry her afterwards. After just a few weeks, that pronouncement came true and the two were wed. Soon after, the couple left Chicago for a new life on the West Coast. After arriving in San Francisco in the summer of 1927, Rexroth wouldn't just experience a cultural renaissance, he would create one. But before we get to that, let's pause for a quick break. Since you're listening to this, chances are you love Hoosier history just as much as we do. If you're interested in conducting your own research and don't know where to start, check out Hoosier State Chronicles, Indiana's digital historic newspaper program at HoosierStateChronicles.org. The project is operated by the Indiana State Library with financial support from the U.S. Institute of Museum and Library Services, along with National Endowment for Humanities National Digital Newspaper Program. You'll find many great resources at Hoosier State Chronicles. You can explore yesteryear's newspapers at your fingertips at HoosierStateChronicles.org. Now, back to the show. Upon their arrival on the West Coast, Kenneth and Andre found exactly what they had hoped for. A rich cultural environment without the stuffiness they had sensed in the East Coast artistic communities. They settled into the San Francisco art community, living what he called a sort of semi-monastic life devoted to writing and painting. The duo also took time to explore the unique flora and fauna that surrounded them, feeding Rexroth's love for nature. This deep-seated respect for the natural world influenced Rexroth's writing. And by the mid-1930s, his poetry was gaining notoriety for combining natural imagery with his radical political and anti-war sentiments. While he was being published more and more regularly, it wasn't enough to fully support the couple, even in their semi-monastic lifestyle. So, in the midst of the Great Depression, Rexroth was employed by the Works Progress Administration's writing program. The steady income provided by the WPA allowed Rexroth to continue focusing on his poetry, leading to the 1940 publication of his first major collection called In Wah Hour, in which he continued exploring his two passions, nature and politics. One reviewer from the Oakland Tribune lauded the work as something entirely different from everything that had come before it, saying, "Rexroth is wholly and essentially a poet in the new manner. Rexroth's political parents, if he has any, are not known." While his career was taking off, his marriage was dissolving. He and Andre fought often over politics, and after she began an affair, Rexroth moved out and began a relationship with Marie Cass, who he later married. While his marriage to Andre didn't last, he was devastated when she died on October 17, 1940. Here's Sherry Wagner reading an excerpt from the poem Andre Rexroth.
"I know that spring again is splendid as ever, the hidden thrush as sweetly tongued, the sun as vital. But these are the forest trails we walked together, these paths 10 years together. We thought the years would last forever. They are all gone now. The days we thought would not come for us are here."
The idea expressed in that excerpt that love and nature could serve as spiritual refuge in troubled times became more poignant with the U.S. entry into World War II in 1941. Rexroth maintained his pacifist, anti-war stance and applied for conscientious objector status in 1943. He backed his beliefs with action by working with several pacifist groups and organizations providing aid to camps of conscientious objectors. He took his activism even further by stepping in to help Japanese Americans avoid internment after President Franklin Roosevelt issued Executive Order 9066, authorizing the relocation of Japanese Americans away from the West Coast to internment camps in the interior of the nation. Rexroth explained how he and Marie saved several Japanese Americans from internment in his autobiography. He recounted that he contacted the Midwest Art Academy in Chicago and convinced them to sign registration papers for Japanese American students for a fee. He then contacted the colonel in charge of the evacuation in San Francisco, who agreed to provide educational passes for these students. Rexroth wrote, "We started shoveling people out of the West Coast on educational passes." Since no official records were kept of this operation, it's hard to say how many were saved in this way, but the fact that the operation happened was corroborated by colleagues of Rexroth. Rexroth incorporated his strongly held beliefs on pacifism, nature, and the power of love into his writing. In his 1944 work, The Phoenix and the Tortoise, he pondered the horrors of the recent war and Holocaust, but still maintained hope for humanity despite its failings. He concluded with imagery of the ocean as sanctuary, and the love of his wife as sublime, cleansing, saving, and immortal. Again, Sherry Wagner reading Rexroth, edited for length.
"And out of this shall I reclaim beauty, peace of soul, the perfect gift of self-sacrifice, myself as act, as immortal person." My wife has been swimming in the breakers. She comes up the beach to meet me, nude, sparkling with water, singing high and clear against the surf. The sun crosses the hills and fills her hair as it lights the moon and glorifies the sea, and deep in the empty mountains melts the snow of winter and the glaciers of 10,000 years.
The end of the war saw an influx of new artists and writers into the San Francisco area. Rexroth himself believed that their arrival was a direct result of the horrors of the war. In the San Francisco magazine, he wrote,
"Just as London under the buzz bombs enjoyed a literary renaissance and a profound change of social relationships, so San Francisco during the war woke up from a long provincial sleep and became culturally a world capital."
And Rexroth became the architect of that cultural world capital by holding weekly gatherings where he hosted readings and introduced poets to each other. Much like the Chicago Renaissance, the budding San Francisco Renaissance combined political discussion, poetry, and jazz. Over the next decade, the foundation laid by Rexroth gave rise to the Beat Generation. And while beat poetry was being produced on the East Coast as well, San Francisco became the heart of the movement in the early 1950s. The Beat Generation, much like Rexroth himself, rejected mainstream culture and politics and expressed themselves through new and non-conventional forms of poetry. One of these non-conventional forms of poetry was descended from Rexroth's days in Chicago, jazz poetry. He was gaining fame for this kind of poetry at the time and was integral in establishing jazz as an essential element of beat poetry. This melding of jazz and poetry can be heard in this clip of Rexroth from the Black Hawk in 1955.
We were falling like meteors down through black holes toward each other, then compact, blazing through air into the earth.
Rexroth was influential in the early years of the Beat Generation. In fact, he organized and hosted the October 7, 1955 poetry reading at the Sixth Gallery, where Allen Ginsberg read his revolutionary poem Howl.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness. Starving, hysterical.
Scholars point to this as the culminating event of the San Francisco Renaissance and solidification of the beat movement. This resulted in his gaining the title Father of the Beat Poets, a title he eventually rejected. Ultimately, he rejected the beat movement as a whole, claiming that it had turned from a literary movement into a quote-unquote hipster lifestyle of pursuing fashionable trends rather than larger truths, and he worked to distance himself from it. Eventually, the beat movement melted into the counterculture movements of the 60s, and rock and roll replaced poetry and jazz as the dominant outlet for rebellious youth. Nonetheless, Rexroth continued to be a central figure in American literature. He continued writing poetry, as well as cultural and literary criticism, and began dedicating more of his time to translating poetry from other languages, primarily Japanese and Chinese. He paid special attention to translating the works of women poets, a practice which had great influence on his own original works from that time. Upon his death in 1982, Kenneth Rexroth received acclaim from both mainstream and radical literary circles. While he's probably best known for the influence he had on the voice and worldview of some of the country's best poets, it's his own unique voice that will forever hold his place in America's literary canon. Once again, I'm Lindsay Beckley, and this has been Talking Hoosier History. If you're interested in learning more about this topic, visit Blogging Hoosier History to read the two-part post by Jill Weiss. Her research for the Indiana State Historical Marker formed the basis of this episode. And thanks again to the Indiana Poet Laureate, Cherry Wagner, who read the poems in this episode. If you would like to hear more from Sherry, visit our website, in.gov/history/talkinghoosierhistory. As usual, thanks to Jill for engineering the sound and Justin Clark for lending his voice to this podcast. Follow us on our brand new Facebook and Twitter accounts, both at Talking Hoosier Hist. That's H-I-S-T. And finally, please subscribe, rate, and review Talking Hoosier History on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.